So here, let me say that again. Is her acting before I think it is? But just because you know that trick doesn't mean you still don't know when to quit. Let me zoom in here so I hope you can see this a little bit better. I'm having a lot of fun doing some real fine details on this face. Not realism details, details of color, abstract details. Like, let me give you a bumpy ride here to pick you up off here and let you come and see this up close. Right, Mr. Connection, I can't see your whole name there, but that's exactly right. That is what's good about modern art. Absolutely. Unfettered experimentation. Exactly. I love it. That's what's good about it. As long as they keep doing that, that's the kind of stuff I love. It's when they spill over into the peachiness that I don't like it. Very good mindset, Kendrick. Very good mindset. It is a journey. And in fact, what you just said, that's all sort of like a corollary to what I was saying earlier. If I set out to communicate a message to the viewers, then I have violated their trust. A very close correlation to that, or corollary to that, is if I know exactly where a painting is going before I start, that's also a violation, not of my viewers, but of my canvas. The canvas that is waiting for me to work on it. I'm going to do at least one more thing before I finish up. I'm quite happy with that, I think. Of course, I reserve the right to look at all this tomorrow with fresh eyes and change my mind. But I'm mixing up now a pale blue color. At the moment, it's a cool blue, kind of slightly purple-ish. This might be too light, I'm not sure. Yeah, that makes me a little nervous. No, I should be bold. Good for you, Heather. Yeah, I think everybody should at least experiment, play with abstract painting. I really do. It teaches you what real painting is, and then you go back and try to apply those same rules to your representation of painting. In a way, all paintings, no matter how realistic they are, they're abstract. They're not real. They're an abstraction of. But that's not the way normal people use the word. So, of course, I'm playing with semantics of it here, but as artists, I think it's very, very important for us to understand that all paintings are abstract. There's not a dual center. There's an awful lot of snobbery. What is snobbery? I'll give you a definition. Here it is. Snobbery is identifying yourself. Hendrick, I'll get to that in a second. Snobbery is identifying yourself by the things you despise or look down upon. That's snobbery.
I don't like that. They're no good. That's bad.
Okay? And I don't think any good thing in our universe should be despised. Okay, what is there to teach? Well, glad you asked, Hendrick. I actually teach that there are six categories of abstract painting. Now, I don't know if I can list them all here all at once. Let me try to do this real quick. Six approaches or six impulses, six types of abstract painting. Now, I have this on, I probably have a YouTube video on this somewhere, so if you just want to YouTube Dan Nelson, six categories of abstract painting, you can probably find it. But one is kinesthetic, compositional, Chance, and I'm not going to come up with six. Want kinesthetic, compositional, process, chance. I'm missing two, but it's things like that. And then the next question would be, well, which one is the best approach to abstract painting? And my answer is all six. If you want to be a good abstract painter, you employ all six of these techniques into your, and I just listed a few, I didn't list six right now. You employ all six of these in your painting process. And most people who dabble and who are bad at abstract painting, they certainly do not utilize all six. Okay, I am just about done here. And actually, to tell you the truth, I'm violating a principle right now, and that is I've been right up close to my canvas for too long of a time. It really is wise to stand back and go back, but I've been talking to you guys and having fun. I mean, at the moment, I think it looks good.
Head on over to sciencebasedsixpack.com right now. My name is Thomas DeLauer, and I'm the lead trainer on SixPackAbs.com, which is YouTube's largest, most subscribed to fitness channel, with over 4.5 million subscribers. But I'm not just an online trainer. You see, I'm actually a professional fitness model. I've been on the covers of magazines, and you've probably seen me on TV as well. But you're probably wondering, well, this guy is just genetically gifted. He's looked like this his entire life. But that couldn't be further from the truth. In fact, this is what I used to look like. I've lost 100 pounds, and most of it was utilizing intermittent fasting, but almost all of it was utilizing science. I've always focused on science, and if you really try to focus on what works in your body and the science of how the cells are actually functioning, you can understand a lot more, and that's exactly why I've created and structured programs that work based on science. And this isn't just science that's worked for me. We're talking about science that's worked for thousands of people. And science has worked for tons of clients that I've worked with in the past. The true way to get a six-pack is not by listening to bro science on the internet and not by listening to fitness gurus who only give you the information that works for the masses. There's nothing wrong with consuming information on the internet, but we have to understand, to get it tailored for you specifically, you have to understand science and you have to understand what's happening in your cells as an individual. So I encourage you to watch the full video so that you can understand exactly how science is working for you and how the five principles that I mentioned can apply directly to getting you the six-pack that you want and to get rid of the belly fat. So head on over to sciencebasedsixpack.com right now. I will see you soon.
build more elaborate shapes on top of these, but this is my starting point. I'm really trying to keep at arm's length, at least, away from my surface as I work, and I tend to hold the brush from the end, especially when I'm starting, because I want to be loose and I want to make large straight lines and angles in a very minimalistic and simplistic way so that I can capture the wholeness of the portrait in just a few basic lines. I want to be loose and I want to be organic, but at the same time, I really want some specificity. And in the beginning, I have a very basic outside shape. But then, once I start to indicate the center line, that's where a little bit of specificity needs to take hold here. So the center line, I've found, is the most vital piece of information in the beginning. Even more vital than the angle of the axis of the eyes and the nose and the mouth. Although, everything is important to a painting. But having the beginning be something that's simple, easy, and organic, and something that you can build from is key towards approaching portrait painting from a very understandable, or at least understandable to me, standpoint. But I just find that the center line I really want to know, is the head straight on, is it three-quarter, or is it profile? Remember, center line is just that line in the middle of the face that you can see at this point here. Is telling me exactly how much space I have from the left to the right. Alright, grabbing another bristled brush, a clean bristled brush that's a little bit more beat up, so this brush is a little bit more rough. I'm going to dab it into some paint thinner and dab it dry, almost completely dry. That's the key word here, almost completely dry. So this brush is going to be my eraser brush. So I use an eraser brush kind of like you would a kneaded eraser with charcoal or any kind of eraser to a pencil. I'm just using it to push the paint around just as you would with an eraser to encourage the specificity of the shapes that I will be building here. I don't always get so elaborate with my initial lines as you've noticed with other portrait painting demonstrations that I've done. I tend to jump into color very, very quickly. But in this case, I really wanted to draw a little bit more, and I wanted to draw a little more specificity early on, but I want to keep the shapes very, very simple. I want it simple to understand. I just want to mark for the features, and I want a simple shape for the outside, but I want them to be as correct as I can get them. Beginning, there can be a lot of tension, especially when you're making a portrait painting of someone you know. You really, or at least I really, really want to get their likeness fairly quickly, and I don't want to insult the person that I'm painting or I'm drawing. But as it turns out, that's not a very good idea or methodology to have in mind. It's important to keep things simple and understandable for you. A brush mark may be a great indication of where a feature is going to go. Just a simple line, as you've seen me indicate, for the eyes, the two eyes and the nose. I'm really trying to play this game where how minimal can I make something, but how accurate can I make it? And it's not the end of the world if I get the eyes a little too far up or a little far down. As long as I stand back and keep a steady distance from my painting as I work, I will see these mistakes. But it's important, at least to me, to keep in mind that I'm not trying to get a perfect likeness, or I'm not trying to make it look extremely pretty in the first brush marks. In fact, I don't even think about that at all. I try to play this game with myself where I'm thinking of shapes. I'm looking at just simple shapes. The idea of how a face should look is instilled in us very early on, and it makes it very, very hard to break from that idea of a face must look like this all the time. It's really about breaking it down into a series of shapes. A series of shapes in which you can accurately place more specific shapes on top of that really helps simplify this process down. But try to hold back from making all these details and making all these eyelashes and things that we're used to seeing in photography and in the day-to-day life, looking at mirrors and everything like that. Let's abstract what it is that we're seeing into an understandable set of basic shapes that can build into more elaborate shapes, thus resulting in that image that you see every single day in photography and in the mirror. Let's build up to that. Now, I'm not saying let's create a photograph by any means. A painting, at least in my opinion, should be an organic understanding of nature. Your interpretation of nature is distilled into the painting. Not the photograph, not the exact person, but being true to yourself, true to your own calligraphy. Each person has their own calligraphy. Each person has their own brushmark. Each person has their own way of interpreting something in the visual realm. And that creates a great variety of elegance and beauty from people's work and how it differentiates from one person to the next. That's what creates that variety and elegance in painting. Now with this painting, I'm developing more of a linear drawing and block in meaning I'm blocking in the entire structure with a few basic lines. That's what I mean by block in. So I'm building up the block in and making it a lot more elaborate than my previous demonstrations. And I've made some videos where I did work in this way as well. This shouldn't be too new, but I'm doing this because I want to have a workable shape. This is going to provide a function for me. Once I have these shapes accurate enough to, let's say, about the accuracy of the thickness of my brush, meaning I should be in the right place to the extent of which it might deviate by the thickness of the side of my size 4 Filbert brush. That kind of accuracy, hopefully it's not too vague, that kind of accuracy is what I want in order to move into color and move into value. Now in this painting, I'm going to do my best to develop the portrait as a set of shapes of value and color. I will be developing the planes. I will be developing the structure using planes, and I'll explain more about that as I go. But this drawing is going to be serving a function for me. I want it to be accurate, but I don't want to be overly laborious in which this drawing will be completely perfect, nothing's wrong with it, super precise, because, at least to me, now this is only something that happens to me. If I develop my drawing in this raw umber so precise and so accurate, I don't leave myself any room to work with. I want it to be something that I can build on top of. And it's not a bad thing at all to draw it to the most perfect degree. Have your drawing as perfectly accurate as possible. In fact, I would encourage you to do that. This is only for me, my personal preference. I don't like to completely nail the drawing, but I want it to be in a workable stage of which I can build more color. Now, if this was a pose that I would be continuing for multiple weeks, yeah, I would definitely build the color. For certain, I would certainly build up the shape and the linear drawing. Now, that is the difference between a one-sitting painting and a painting that I will be working on for multiple sittings. A painting that I will be working on for multiple sittings, I will certainly spend all my time perfecting these lines. That's the difference. But, not to fret, the result, at least for me, tends to be very similar. It's just that when I work on a painting for multiple sittings, there tends to be a higher level of refinement. But that refinement is shown even in my one-sitting Alla Prima paintings in a more simplistic and minimalistic way. I try to distill the entirety of the painting into basically shape, value, and color. That's my methodology, that if I get the shape right, then I can place the value where it needs to be. And if I get the value right, then I have room of which I can adjust the color. So that's really the fundamentals, in my opinion. The shape determines where I can place the value, and the value determines where I can adjust the color. To further elaborate on this, I'm right now developing the shape. I'm spending a lot of time making minor adjustments now. I'm moving the eyes up a little bit, I may move the nose down, and I may move the mouth up, but I have a very defined center line, at least in my head. I have a very defined idea of how the head is turned. Remember I said the center line is that defining factor in the beginning, at least to me. I did move the eyes up a little bit on the axis. Very, very minimal change. I used my drawing brush to push them a little bit higher up on the eye socket. Let's get into the shape. The shape is something that can be encompassed in just a few lines. Therefore, the shape is a very easy concept in which you can abstract the entirety of the portrait. You can capture the whole portrait in just a few lines. That's the beauty and that's the elegance of the shape. Now, when we work into value, value simply is just how light or how dark is a particular area on the surface. Now, value to me is the fastest and most efficient way to express form. That is because, if you think about it, if that were not true, then black and white photography wouldn't exist, and charcoal drawings and pencil drawings would not hold an image. Now, the power light and shadow, if anything, all I have is an indication of the cheekbone, the little mark that I have to the left, and that's it. I don't really have any other values on the face other than light and shadow. And a line from the axis of the eyes to the bottom of the nose. Picture that line in your head. Now picture a line from the bottom of the nose to the chin. That's another line. These two lines are lines that we can compare to one another. One may be bigger than the other in such a way that we can relate them to each other. And let's do this using our eye first. Let's bounce our eyes back and forth from the painting to the model. Bouncing our eyes back and forth from the painting to the model really helps us see the changes that need to be made. It really helps us see proportion. To me, it's always such an astounding thing that to notice when I stand further back and bounce my eyes back and forth, how simple the changes can be. And that's not always the case. Sometimes the changes can be more difficult. But at least in this simple shape idea, the change is often a brush mark to push an eye up or push a nose down relative to each other. Alright, switching over to a different brush, a new brush. or at least a clean brush, I'm dabbing it into my medium and then dabbing it dry on the paper towel. So I'm going to be mixing up a combination of burnt umber, sap green, and a little bit of ivory black to give me a dark value. I don't want it to be straight black, but a fairly dark value. And I'm going to use this to start to place some dark accents in the hair. So now we're going to be getting into value. Now the transition from shape to value can be a very, very simple transition, because if you have the shape down as accurately placed as you can put it, then it can necessitate the values. Now you can see that I'm breaking down the hair into a set of dark shapes. And these dark shapes are planes. A plane is a simplified three-dimensional concept of a flat surface in space. What that means is that the plane change can be indicated by the value change. Just the value change indicates the plane change by itself. This is why I said that value alone can give you the fullness of a form in a very, very cool light, warm shadow, warm light, cool shadow. Really just mean that the shadow is a little bit warmer than the flesh colors. And that's often the case even in warm light settings. It all depends on the environment. But for this value, I just wanted it to be dark, but not as dark as the dark accents of the hair, and a little bit warm. Now for this painting, since I was able to take the photograph in natural light, there was a lot of nice and beautiful, elegant colors. So throughout the rest of this demonstration, you're going to be seeing a lot more of my palette. So my palette's really going to be a star here. You're going to see these mixtures develop one after the other in a way a little bit more elaborate than my previous videos. I'm definitely going to try to impose on you the color changes and the color relations relative to one another. But to get started, I still think about value primarily. Now, the transition from shape to value can happen in a simple way if you take the time to really stand back and squint at your model. But let me guide you through it, just because I was able to photograph the model in natural light, under a natural light. So we're going up in the value scale. Remember, I'm thinking primarily of value. We're going up in the value scale, that is, we're going a little bit lighter, and now I'm starting to indicate a different plane. The plane for the side of the nose is a little bit lighter than the side planes closest to the cast shadow. But they're still relatively dark relative to the other planes. So that's why I'm building my way up on the value scale. From a structural standpoint, we have the zygomatic bone, the cheekbone, across the side of the face with its darker value. And we have the side plane of the nose, as you've seen me indicate. Now we're rolling around the bottom of the jaw, creating another value change. Still with the same brush, it's just that I'm applying less and less paint to get that gradation. And then the side of the eye socket, we have that deep, dark value. On the value scale, I'm introducing more and more alizarin crimson, lead white, and raw umber. That mixture I found with this painting is helping me get a nice warm middle ground of which I can build more colors on top of. I also put in a little bit of sap green into the mix to cool it down. So as I go and progress into the face, I'm working my way up the value scale. But I'm also providing a warmer and darker ground. And that is so that I can build more elaborate colors on top of. but I'm also trying not to overly saturate the colors either. Remember, saturation would be straight up yellow, straight bright yellow, or straight bright red. I don't want that in the portrait. I want a nice middle ground of which I can work to create more elaborate colors. Now, challenge in Alla Prima is to get shape, value, and color working as accurately as possible. But I am definitely trying to simplify it down in the sense that I spent a lot of time figuring out the shape. On the palette, I'm ordering the values so that I keep my values in check. And I'm keeping a consideration for the structure of the face to guide my values. And then ultimately with the color, I'm thinking of it very, very minimalistically and at a very, very refined, simple manner. I'm gauging the colors in relation to each other as more yellow, more pink, or more green. And I'm trying to relate the overall shape of that value first before I change the color in any way. Because remember, you can always change the color a little bit. It's much more difficult to figure out what that value is supposed to be. Now remember that each value change is a plain change. You saw me earlier put that more yellowish value on the cheekbone, and that is a very predominant plain change. The forehead, that value I just placed, was a very predominant plain change. And now I'm applying it onto the nose with the same brush. So I'm definitely trying to simplify things down by unifying the so taking into consideration. I'm applying more paint in some areas by pressing down harder on the brush. And I'm applying less paint in some areas by applying on that underlying structure of the value. It can give you such an elegance in color. There's no such thing as an ugly color. It's just a color that wasn't related well to the surrounding colors. That's the other color, because